morning's alert. Good morning, Facebook.
Good morning, YouTube.
There's
good morning, Cowboy Church.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Don't you leave today, man.
Huh?
Don't you leave today.
Stand up for this one. Let's stand up and sing.
Thank you.
problems this morning, so I'm having to take lots of pauses. Y'all can have a seat. That's Cowboy Church.
That's Cowboy Church.
Oh, okay. Because I'm like, where are you? Okay. Well, we're on the same.
Oh, give me 1 second, Pastor Lynn. I got to pause. Why are you going to say pause?
Oh, just hit pause.
Mm-hmm. I got to pause for you. Oh, Lord.
Philipppians.
And we're going to begin reading at verse 4. Man, this looks good. See all these folks here. The title of the message today is How to Live in Joy. And I was just sitting there thinking, it's best saying, and we're going to be baptizing Luke immediately after this, and as he begins a new life in Christ, what better message for him to hear than how to live a life of joy? Now, I want to tell you, we're not talking about happy clappy, okay? There's a huge difference between happiness and joy. We're going to be talking about that. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Our Father, may the words of our mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Father, we just give you all the praise for all that's going on here today and each day in Cowboy Church and in all the churches in our area. Father, we just praise your holy name. We're so thankful for Jesus that came as a baby, that preached for 3 years, that was allowed himself to be put to death on a cross, died, arose again in 3 days, and is alive sitting at your right hand today. Because of all that, we can say that we have salvation. We will have eternal life with you in heaven. Father, we just give you all the praise. Father, give me the boldness that I may speak your word with confidence. And we thank you again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, Philippians 4:4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice. Let me try that again. Rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We think sometimes that because we're a believer, because we believe in Jesus, that we have to go around with old long things. I'm holy now. I'm holy. I can't have fun and I can't have a good time. The Apostle Paul told us to rejoice. I heard a preacher a long time ago when I was a kid. He said that there was such a thing as mule faced Baptists, and I think that's appropriate in Cowboy Church to hear about mule faced Baptists. He said to go around with a face so long and say, I'm holy, I love Jesus, I'm rejoicing, oh, woe is me. And they just mule faced Baptists. We don't want to give that appearance to the world. We want to rejoice. We want other people to want what we got. My prayer for Luke today is that his friends, the people he works with, family, will say, you know, there's something different in that boy, and I want some of what he's got. I want that.
Amen.
I want to experience that. I want to feel that. What I love about the Apostle Paul, when he tells us something, he tells us how to do it. He says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evidence to all. And then he says, the Lord is near. Now, if you read that, and that's sort of a double entendre there, the Lord is near. He's saying that the day of the Lord, that Jesus is going to come back. He's coming back soon. And I believe it's getting nearer and nearer than it's ever been. But he's also saying, you know, in Matthew 28, beginning with verse 18, the last command Jesus gave to us, he said that all power in heaven and earth is given unto me, Jesus. Go ye therefore, make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and I will go with you to the end of the age. Franklin Roosevelt, long time ago, said, walk softly and carry a big stick. Walk softly. Be kind to others. Be gentle, as Paul said here. We don't have to, like, we don't have to go around with a long face. We don't have to go around angry all the time either. As we approach other people, like I said, we want them to want some of what we got. And if we're angry all the time, or if we're sad all the time, who's going to want some of that, you know? Jesus is with you everywhere you go. So we can be kind, we can be nice to folks, we can treat other people with respect, knowing that wherever we go, whatever we do, Jesus is with us every day. We talk about it all the time here in Cowboy Church. We don't want to just come to church. You know, I came to church, today's Sunday, I came to church, I got my little dose of religion this week, I'm good to go for a while. Well, it don't work that way. We're talking about being the church. Do you know where Cowboy Church is? Sometimes it's here. Sometimes it's at Philo, isn't it?
Yep.
Travis. Sometimes it's down here at the three-way having a cup of coffee. We are the church. Where we go, that's not necessarily Cowboy Church, but the church, we need to be the church. We need to be who Jesus called us to be, and that's to be the church. We don't want, I wish everybody would just quit going to church and start being the church. Don't just quit going to church. Don't stop there, but start being the church. Take the church with you everywhere you go. Be church, and you'll see a huge difference in your life. Paul goes on to say, do not be anxious about anything. Oh, boy. Don't be anxious about anything. How are we going to do that? Paul says, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now that's a mouthful. That sounds good. That sounds like something I ought to do. But how do I do that? Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. We've all heard trash in, trash out, and we fill our minds with trash all the time. We look at all kind of junk. We own our phones, computers, whatever. We talking trash to our friends, you know. But whatever goes in is what comes out. If we always talking depression and down and oh, woe is me and the world after me, you know, I'm all by myself. Well, you're not all by yourself. If you've got Jesus Christ in your life, you've got the creator of this universe. You've got the man that created you with you everywhere you go, every day. So then we focus on whatever is true. There's a lot being said today about truth. Truth is relevant. Really? If you really believe something, then it must be true, right? I want everybody in here to line up after church. I've got a ladder out here. And we're going to go up on the top of this building, one by one, and I'm going to hand you a concrete block. I want you to believe with everything in you, with all your power and strength, that concrete block is a helium-filled balloon, and then step off the top of this building. And somebody dial 911. Because ain't none of us gonna float, Lord. Truth is truth. Fact is fact. It's not relevant. It's not what you believe it to be today. And then you believe something else tomorrow. Truth is truth. Fact is fact. We need to understand that. And then concentrate on what? Whatever is true. Whatever is noble. Whatever is right. If you ever started to do something and say, is that right? Should I be doing it? Oh, I'm going to go ahead and do it anyway. No, we can't do that. Can't do it. We have to do what's right. Okay. Whatever is lovely. Do you think about junk all the time? You know, we need to dust our brain out up there. Put some good stuff in there. Whatever is admirable. Man, I'd like to be admirable. Well, it helps if I begin by having admirable thoughts. And then he goes on to say, put into practice what you've learned, and the God of peace will be with you. That's awesome. Paul tells us what to do, and then he tells us how to do it. And that's an awesome, awesome thing. In the very end of the letter to the Philippians, Paul's original purpose was to write them and thank them for a financial gift that they had sent to him. Now, this is sort of personal with me, okay? You see, I was a traveling evangelist for 6 years. And I had to depend on the goodness of churches. You know, just because a guy is a preacher or an evangelist or something, you know, you can't go up to Aiken Electric Co-op and say, God bless y'all, and they stamp your bill pay. It don't work that way. They want money. And people can't seem to understand that itinerant evangelists need money. They need a way to pay the bills. And I can't tell you how many times over the years that people would come up and say, Brother, I want to pray with you. I want to pray with you about your finances. And I want to share with you where Paul was a tent maker. That means he worked and provided for himself. Oh, but there's something there. Paul only did that for 18 months. The first 18 months that he was a missionary, and he worked. After that, he depended. Look at verse number 14. It says, yet it was good of you to share in my troubles. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you only. Now, the church at Philippi was a church Paul planted. They didn't forget him. They sent a financial gift to him. For even when I was in Thessalonica, which was another town, he was planting another church, you sent me aid again and again. So they did it more than one time. It wasn't, well, we're going to give you this gift one time and that's it. They kept on. We've got a church that is still supporting Cowboy Church. We've got internet calls. We've got a company out of McKinney, Texas, that helps us get our weekly messages out on Facebook. We have people listening to us right now in Nova Scotia, in Japan, Mexico. They're hearing what we're saying. You're playing a part in that just by being here. But we've got a church that still supports all of that. Even though I've been at Cowboy Church for 10 years, they still give to us. They help us pay that bill we have to pay. And that's awesome. That's awesome. So that's why I say this is sort of personal to me. Paul goes on in verse number 17 and says, not that I am looking for a gift, but I'm looking for what may be credited to your account. For I have received full payment and even more. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts that you sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. And my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. To God and Father be glory forever and ever. Our offerings that we give need to be a time of worship. Now here at Cowboy Church, we leave that offering bucket sitting on the table there. We don't ever pass it around. You know, you go to church and they pass the plate. I was at the church one time and the guy was taking a offering and he passed the plate down the row and it came back to him and it didn't have anything in it. He says, boom, and passed it again. And I thought, that's not right. Your offering should be a time of worship. And you give it to God. We give to God. And that's what we need to do. So if you have a gift today, say a prayer and drop it in the bucket. Whenever you want to. Whenever God moves on your heart. And my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. To God and Father be glory forever and ever. In just a few minutes, we're going to go outside. We're going to set Facebook Live up again. And we're going to baptize Luke as he begins his new life in Christ. A baptism is your first formal announcement. Luke, you don't wash away your sins. Jesus did that on the cross 2,000 years ago. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, he did. He did. He washed away our sins on the cross 2,000 years ago. He offered a gift of salvation, and Luke accepted. When he accepted that gift, he was born again and became a new man in Christ. Will he still mess up sometime? I'm afraid so. God don't make us perfect. He just makes us saved. Okay? But God will guide you as you go each day. And this baptism will be your first formal announcement that you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior. It's an awesome time in the life of a believer. We just got news today. There's a young lady that we have been talking to at Philo. She helps us with our food pantry. And we're going to be baptizing her next week. So I hope we keep that trough full for a while. Amen. Let's pay off a word of prayer. Father, we just thank you so much. We thank you for who you are. We just give you all the praise, all the glory, for all that you're doing. We thank you for Luke and for his testimony. He didn't take this lightly. He didn't make a sudden decision. Luke asked a lot of questions. He talked to us over several weeks before he chose to make this step. He wanted to be confident in what he was doing. Father, we thank you so much for Jesus, that he went to the cross, that 2,000 years ago, each of us that are believers, our sins was nailed to that cross. Father, we just praise you. We thank you that you had a plan before the dawn of time whereby we might choose you, we might choose to spend eternity in heaven with you. But it's so much more than that, God. It's a new life here on earth in Christ. We just thank you for that. We thank you for the Bible that we have to direct our path every day, to not only guide us towards heaven, but to show us how we can live our life daily. We just thank you for that. Father, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, if everybody will assemble outside, we're going to set the cameras up again, okay? We need to move on from I messed up, you know. So I'm moving forward, keeping my eye on the prize. In chapter 4, the first verse, Paul says, therefore, he's talking about all this other stuff he said. Therefore, my brothers, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown. Paul planted the Philippian church. He said that he heard a call from Macedonia to come over, and the Philippian church was the church that he first planted there. And he says, That is how you should stand firm in the Lord, dear friends. All right, now why is that so important? See, if you go back to the first chapter,